Well, good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Welcome to the Salvation Army. This is our church. I'm the pastor, Captain Carl DeLee. It's my pleasure to welcome you here to the Salvation Army. Now, this piece that we just listened to, there's a little bit of a story behind it, and I thought it would be good for us to tell you why it is that we play Fanfare for the Common Woman.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for being here. Dolly Sherman's, one of her favorite pieces, one of her favorite composers was Aaron Copland. And we renamed that piece. We played a short excerpt from it, but it's so the actual title is Fanfare for the Common Man. We thought it was appropriate to play Fanfare for the Common Woman in honor of Dolly. That was the purpose of that little fanfare. Thank you.
I think she was anything but common. She was a fantastic lady. I'm going to read to you from the scriptures, Psalm 150. If you have your Bibles, it's Psalm 150. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and the lyre. Praise him with the tambourine and the dancing, and praise him with strings and flute. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Again, I want to welcome you to the Salvation Army. That part of the Universal Christian Church has a rather unique history. Some of you, though, are not new here. I've seen a lot of faces I recognize. Especially there in the back. Welcome back. Many of the productions that have been put on by Peg and Dolly have had their venue right here. So for you, it's welcome back. For all of you else who are coming to show your support, I want to thank you. We're still waiting for some who are traveling and are trying to get here. So grateful to see so many faces that have come out in support. So thank you for coming. We're going to hold on our family introductions until such time as they arrive. We're going to sing together tonight, The Old Rugged Cross. We're going to sing verses 1 and 3 together. The words are going to be up on the screen.
Thank you.
like to introduce some of Dolly's family members that are here. I don't know all of them. Would you like to lead the introductions?
Gary, her brother.
Her brother. Gary Sherman. And then we have
Tim. Gary's son and his wife.
All right.
Teresa.
And
then his daughter Jennifer.
Hi, Jennifer.
And her brother Carly. And I don't know where the other two are.
Hello, Mike. Welcome. We're so glad to have you guys. You know what you do. You know, part of, I can't say a part of Dolly's life. It seemed like it was her whole life, it seems like. It seemed to be filled with music. And so I think it's appropriate that we're surrounded by musicians tonight, of every type. If we could take a survey, I think we would find we've got enough for a whole orchestra. Does everybody bring your instruments tonight? All right, you didn't know we were going to have an impromptu band. But thank you for coming. You've all been touched. We all have, at least in some part, by her ministry of music. And so I welcome you again here. We're going to hear from Pastor David Benway. He's going to tell us a little bit about Dolly's faith story. I met Pastor David on a few occasions. Most of the time that we met, it was at a musical production or at the hospital. We've had some great talks in both places, yes. Come and share with us.
Okay, the program said that I'm going to talk about Dolly's Christian life. Yes, but I will deviate. When Peg asked me to do this, she handed me this little book here. It's called The Commitment Factor. And it's got a whole story in here about Dolly. So I've stole a little of it. What I'm going to say. But I do want to talk about Dolly's Christian journey. I have to tell you, when she was just 4 years old, her mother moved to the old farmhouse in Fort Foote, Maryland. Does anybody know where that is? Because I had never heard of Fort Foote, Maryland until I read this book. She lived with a grandmother and a great uncle for 28 years. And as she said, her attendance at church was rather sporadic. Well, if you knew Dolly, you would know that, yes, that's a true statement. It was certainly sporadic. In any case, that was where and how Dolly, as they say, got dunked and baptized in the Baptist church. That was back in 1943. Dolly was only 8 years old. And as she always said, she was a Baptist before she ever knew what a Baptist was. And if you think about it, when you baptize children at very young ages, they really don't have any idea what the church is. But early life was a very difficult one. It was difficult at home. It was difficult at school. But somewhere along in that school, she was introduced to music. She had a good voice, learned how to play the trumpet, and she was a bit of a discipline problem, both at church and at home. That's the Dolly I know. Okay. But when they moved back to Fort Foote, Dolly joined a group that was starting a new Baptist church, was part of the original 12 people. And that's the story that I'm talking about. It's in this little book here called The Commitment Factor. Dolly was one of the original 12 that started this church. She worked extremely hard with the other 11 to build the first one down there in Port Totten. Because you see, when Dolly first started going to church down there, it was in a tent with traveling pastors. And that's basically what we used to have back then, was traveling pastors. And a lot of tent preachers would come around. Dolly and another individual provided the music for that church. Dolly played the trumpet, and the other one played the piano. And as she grew in music, people began to know who Dolly was. And she was so talented in her music that she was invited to join the Woman's Air Force Band at one time. She denied or refused to go at the time because of various problems. But she continued to grow in musical knowledge, which would be her life's work. She taught children's Bible study classes, was invited to do an adult sermon at that little church at one time. I read her sermon that she wrote. She did a good job. But then I don't think anybody would have argued with her anyways. Yeah, the family's not in the head. No, they're not going to argue with Dolly. No. But as I said, her attendance was rather sporadic and things, and Dolly began to get more and more interested in Christian study. Because of her early childhood, she struggled with the Christian life. She fought with it a lot. Church was a hit or miss activity. And I'm sure some of the, quote, rules and regulations that the Baptist Church had, and I'm going to use the word had because a lot has changed, didn't fit with her lifestyle at all. And didn't fit with some of the wants that she had too. So, but she was there, she was active, and she helped build that church. And she became very active in teaching the young. She loved the young people, the students. But it was because of the pastors and people of the Fort Foot Church that Dolly realized that her church life needed something more. She began to read, ask questions, felt in her heart that spiritually she was growing. And at age 22, she became a born-again Christian. Some are going to say, what in the world is that? Come see me at my church, I'll be glad to tell you. She thought she was being called to be a missionary, but learned very quickly that she couldn't lead until she learned how to follow. Like I said, Dolly had a discipline problem. She had trouble following the teachers in school, and she had trouble following the pastors at the time, okay, when she was young. But the Lord chose rather to reveal to her that she had a voice, and once again she was drawn right back to music. Now she tried various endeavors to earn a living. She spent 14 years working for an insurance company, and after that, several jobs that just didn't pan out. The church was still a hit or miss activity. But Dolly was becoming well known in the area, and her musical talent brought her into contact with many people that recognized her talents and her teaching ability. And I'm glad to see some of the students here. There's some I recognize. And as things often happen, Dolly met Peg, part of the twosome, troubled twosome. And they became good friends, which led to a 40-plus year partnership, okay? Best friends, business partners, and lots of religious study. Music was their love, and they both were teachers, and so it was only natural that their business would cover more than 40 years. More than 40 years. A lot of businesses don't ever make it to 40 years. And those two were able to stay together in the business. There was, however, one little item that was a constant question. It came up usually on Saturdays and Sundays. Because, you see, they both had religious holidays, but not the same ones. Yeah. So, you see, Peg was Jewish. Dolly was a Baptist. So they began to teach each other about their different religions. Dolly said it was a tough job. It took her 25 years to convert Peg. And you go someplace. You're hungry. Peg said she taught Dolly the Old Testament. Dolly taught Peg the New Testament. And that was the best thing that could have happened. Because both of them blossomed and gained so much knowledge into the Christian religion. A lot of things that Dolly struggled with in her Christian knowledge seemed to fade away over the years, but the problems of some of her youth continued to bother her. Now, I met Peg and Dolly in 2007 when they were looking for a pastor for their church in Clarksburg. Somehow I found myself coming out of retirement. I found it as hard to say no to Dolly as I did to my wife. And that was the beginning of a friendship that's lasted right to today. When the Clarksburg Church had to leave that rental space they were in, I found myself retired again. There just wasn't enough people to justify the expense of trying to open another church in Clarksburg, so Peg and Dolly, they went and they played in several different churches. About 2 years later, the Travilla Baptist Church was looking for someone to sub for their pastor who wanted to go on vacation, and they were playing the music out there, and they said, well, why don't you call Pastor Dave? Well, that ended retirement number two. Well, I subbed out there, and then I was asked to get him back again, but by then our traveling musicians had traveled to other churches. And I thought, well, that's probably going to be the end of that, but they moved to Churchill Senior Center. Anybody from Churchill here? Beautiful place, wonderful people out there. And they decided that they were going to start having some musical programs out there. They had these all these wonderful students, very talented students that could play, and so they decided to put in holiday parties. And I got a call from Dolly, and she said, Pastor Dave, she said, we want to have you come out as master of ceremonies, because not only do we want you to kind of lead the program, but we want you to bring in the religious part of the program. Now, little did I know when I said, sure, I'd be glad to help out, that just how many programs a year they were going to have. I mean, but you know, what the heck, a full-time pastor doesn't have anything to do, you know that, right? Most people think that. But I couldn't say no. The band they put together, though, for these programs was made up of their students, and their performances, I have to tell you, was by far top-notch. And of course, the MC was fantastic. Oh, I shouldn't have put that in there. I guess I could have left that out, but you know, what the heck. But I can remember talking to Peg and Dolly and telling them that the music that I was beginning to hear from these students was far above the level of what some of the other bands in the area were doing. And at the time, I was the lieutenant governor of Division 17 here in Montgomery County for Kiwanis International. I was approached by the governor and asked if I could find a band for a program of faith, a celebration of spirit that they wanted to put on. It was the largest program that this division had ever attempted. To say the least, the program was a tremendous success. because the band that was there was the band that Peg and Dolly put together. It was phenomenal. With standing ovations, it was absolutely, by far, the best musical program that I have ever heard. We did a full range of music of all the faiths. Dolly sang the Jewish songs, which I thought Peggy did a good job, because she was, her Jewish talk was very good anyways. But the students taking a lesson from Peg and Dolly had to be in a class by themselves, and I said many times that I think any one of those students could take and go from Dolly's and go into any band and be the lead in that band, because they were phenomenal. The Lands have played for many programs throughout the county, and Dolly will be missed beyond belief for what she has given to these children that she has taught. Now, I've had many a meal with Peg and Dolly, many services. The knowledge that these two have of scriptures is on par with anyone who has gone through a seminary college. I have to tell you, though, that Dolly had ghosts from the past that kept constantly asking if she was good enough to get into heaven. Over the years, I must have tried several times to talk to Dolly and tell her that, you know, things in the past were in the past, and she didn't have to worry about it. But it was a struggle for her, right up almost to the end. And I can tell you this, that Dolly and Peg have played in numerous churches, at many programs, parties throughout Montgomery County. And when I was asked to MC, it was to ensure that during those programs there would be prayer and instructions. They always made sure it was in there. I have to tell you, I watched them smile every time a new student came in. And I watched them cry every time one of those students graduated and moved on. And I can remember a gentleman sitting right over there that used to film those things out at Churchill. And I can remember a young lady that played in the band. Yeah. And let me tell you, she was phenomenal. And I used to tell him, you know, I think your daughter is one of the best I've ever heard. She was phenomenal. My friends, I have to tell you, to know Dolly was to love Dolly. She was a very complex person, but she was a wonderful woman, a teacher of music that I feel all teachers should emulate. Like I said, I watched students that could hardly play a note yet when they came in, but by the time they graduated from school, they had just grown tremendously. Now, I know it says in the program that I was going to talk to you about Dolly's Christian life, but you don't have time enough in this program for me to talk too much about Dolly's knowledge and problems. The biggest problem being that she did not feel that she was good enough to get into heaven, and I fought with her on that. But I have to tell you, when Dolly was in the hospital, and I'd go visit, and I would talk about it. And when she was sent over to the rehab, Genesis they called it, and I thought, Genesis, that's the beginning. If you look at our Bible, Genesis is the beginning. And for Dolly, it was to be the beginning. Because I knew, and Peg knew, that Dolly wasn't going to come back home. That was the place where she was going to meet our Lord. And Dolly, I remember when I was down there on the night before she passed away, and she was struggling hard to breathe. And if you've ever watched somebody in that kind of a situation, that is very difficult. But Dolly struggled and she wanted to talk. And we talked. And I told her, I said, Dolly, you have nothing to worry about. I said, your Lord and Savior already has a place for you. It's already. The room is there. And you're going to see your mom and all those friends that you had. You're going to see students that have moved on and gone to heaven. You're going to see everybody. And that woman, as sick as she was, grabbed me right by the head, pulled me down, and she whispered in my ear. She said, Pastor Dave, I love you, and I'm not worried anymore, because I know my place is in heaven, and I'm ready to go. Those were the last lucid words that I heard from Dolly. But I could tell you right now, she was a tough lady, but she was a good lady. And I'm going to miss that woman, some fierce. But I thank God I still have one of the friends left over there, sitting there. Now this, my friends, is a celebration of life. That's what you're here for. Celebrate the life of Dolly. Don't mourn it. Celebrate it. Think of some of the songs that she loves. Think of some of the hymns that she played. Think of the students that she taught. Yeah. And let me tell you, folks, Dolly right now is probably leading the biggest band you ever saw up in heaven. And she's probably got a group of students lined up waiting to take lessons. I'm going to miss that lady tremendously. God bless you, Dolly.
I want to introduce you to Pal Freak, who's been with Dolly and I for over 20 years. By special request of the family, how great thou art. Judith and I have done this song many, many, many times. And in honor of Dolly and her family, we're very good. Here we go.
I have to put my glasses on because I can't get old. I can't see without these. Okay. Thank you.
scarce can take it in, that on the cross my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation, and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great
logical order or sequence. We're here today to honor Dolly Marie Sherman, my best friend and business partner for 45 years. Dolly began her love of music by playing guitar as a young child and progressed to trumpet in high school, as you'll see from some of the pictures on the display board as well as up on the screen. She used both these instruments in church when she was at the Fort Foote Baptist Church. This began her lifelong travel as not only a child of God, but also a musician. Her ultimate goal of being a music educator began at Prince George's Community College. Under the tutelage of Dr. Frank Seminelli, who was a retired Navy bandsman, he gave her opportunities to play her trumpet, sing in choirs, in such places such as Foundry Methodist Church in D.C., Second Presbyterian Church in Alexandria, and performed with small bands and orchestra throughout the greater Washington area. Prior to completing her degree for a music educator, she was offered a position with the elementary schools within the Washington Archdiocese Music Education System. At the same time as when I came into her life, and being active duty military myself, I got her a job at the youth centers at both Andrews and Bowling Air Force Base, where she started music programs for instrumental music and included me as a piano teacher. Our program got so big, we had over 150 students enrolled. She had to hire a third teacher, which she took from her ranks of the more advanced guitar students. Subsequently, we moved to Montgomery County, and we kind of digressed a little bit, and we had a horse farm. And thus you see the pictures. I've been riding horses since I was, I want to say, 8-10 years old, on and off all my life. And Dolly knew a plow horse, and she could jump on a bareback to go plow the fields, but she never had formal riding until I came into her life. But at the same time, we were up in Clarksburg, and through the Baptist Church there, and we started as church musicians as a team. So, subsequently, we went to other churches, such as Pastor Beverly Stang from Salem United Methodist Church up here in Damascus. When she retired, she went to Homewood Crumbland Retirement Center up in Frederick County. And we were asked to do a music program up there. which was the first time Traveling Light Ensemble was created. Of those 10 students that went to Frederick, 2 are still with us, Linda and her son Michael. From that original 10, 2006, 2 were still with us. Simultaneously, I was about to lose my job as a transcriber from orthopedic surgeon. I was reading the paper looking for a job, and I saw an ad for music lessons in your home under the direction of Mr. and Mrs. Jarman. For 17 years, Dolly and I taught students under their reference. Mr. Charney gave me a copy of the roster of Dolly's students. She touched the lives of 80 families. Of those 80, out of 17 years, 11 are with us here today. Chris and some of you others. We know Dolly was quite a fighter, as Pastor Dave said. I no sooner got the Christmas music filed, and she's talking about a June 9th concert. And up until the last 3 weeks of life, that was the carrot in front of Dolly to keep going. That concert, she wanted to go. Unfortunately, it didn't come. She was loved, and she's going to be missed. You're welcome to peruse the display board. I don't think Max has put out the sample programs, but there are some up on the screen. And I'm going to yield the floor to anyone that wants to make any comments, but I believe, Brother Steve, I'd like to have you do first. You got something to say?
I had the opportunity to prepare a couple things that would be a little different than what Ms. Pay had to say. So if you bear with me. My name is Steve Klitsch. Some of you recognize me as the most mature member of the Traveling Light Orchestra. I prefer to say mature as opposed to old. Dolly called me her little brother. And Mr. Sherman, in all due respect, I didn't know we were related until today. But when somebody calls you their little brother, there's a certain responsibility that comes with that. And I had some things that I wanted to share because she depended on me quite a bit. But I did want to ask Captain Carl. I said, one of my career things is I'm also a paid professional speaker. How much time do we have today?
Only about 67 more minutes.
All right. Anyways, as a little brother, I had to take time to get to know Dolly Marie Sherman. DMS, Dolly Marie Sherman. How about we change that to Doing Music Special? DMS, Doing Music Special. That was one of her favorite things. I have talked to Peg a lot in the last couple weeks about a variety of things, helping you out with things around the house, helping to prepare for this. Peg gave me a couple bags of papers, now that Dolly has passed, medical records and things that weren't needed anymore, so she asked me to shred them. That gave me the opportunity to kind of go through those things. But to add to what Pastor Dave said about her Christian journey and her music career, I looked at Dolly's records from Bowie State College, her actual report cards. And you look at, she took beginner trumpet, got an A. Beginner guitar, got an A. Music composition, got an A. Mathematics, C. Next semester, she's taking beginning saxophone, beginning clarinet, A's in both those courses. Teaching mathematics, guess what she got? Withdrawal. That was on her transcript from Bowie State College. She withdrew from teaching mathematics. She knew where her place was. It was going to be in teaching music. Dolly never gave birth to a child, but she had hundreds of children that she cared for in her career. Real estate professionals will tell you the average household has 2.3 children. Dolly had 2.3 hundreds of children that she cared for musically. As Pastor Dave visited with Dolly on Wednesday, it would have been June 6th. Dolly passed on June 7th. I visited with Dolly quite a few times as she was at Shady Grove and at the Genesis Center. On Monday, June 4th, was the last conversation I had with Dolly. Hospice had told Peg that her time was very short, maybe days and not weeks. So I spent some time with her. I sat by her hospital bed and she insisted I feed her ice cubes that she could crunch on, and she would spit that back up and some blood and things. I asked one of the hospice people, I said, can you come here in here and look at this? I said, is this healthy? Do we need to do something with this? I said, she's not eaten in 8 days. This isn't jello she's spitting up. You know, it's something there. He took a look at it and off he went. But during that conversation, Dolly was very upset. She said she wanted to go. I want to leave this place. So I told her, I said, Dolly, God has 7 billion people he's looking after right now. Your turn will come. You've got to be patient. And then she told me, as she told Pastor Dave, she says, I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy. And I told her, I said, yes, you are. If I could paraphrase Proverbs chapter 12, verse 2, the Lord blesses good people. Dolly was a very good person. Luke, in one of his verses, says, nothing is impossible without God. Meaning Dolly could enter the gates of heaven. And it wasn't until after that, it was the next day, and I had a phone conversation with Peg about Dolly's condition and when we could go visit again. This would have been Tuesday now. Peg, finally, after telling me, you know, again with her stories of 45 years of partnership. And in today's society, as God has created us in his own image, he's also created us as a species that longs for companionship. And that's what Dolly and Peg were with each other. They were life partners. They were companions. But because of certain laws and certain regulations, marriage in their early time was not permitted, but now it is in many different jurisdictions. But I finally figured it out what Peg told me. She said Dolly was not worthy because she did not take a husband in her life. She had a different life partner, and therefore she felt she wasn't worthy. We prayed over this, and I told her, I said, you are worthy because you are a child of God, and he will make a place for you. So before I left that afternoon, that Monday afternoon, I told Dolly, I said, I want you to come back and spook me. I want you to come back and haunt me when you pass. And she says, when I leave here, I'm not coming back. You know, she was a little abrasive sometimes as she taught with her students, and I witnessed this many times, and I thought, wow, I'm thinking she's a little bit hard on these students. But you know what she was actually doing? She was trying to draw out the best of each of you. I never took a trombone lesson from Dolly because it's the only instrument she never learned how to play. And I know this because on her Bowie State College transcript, never did she take beginner trombone. But I learned some things from her as the way that she taught her students and encouraged them to try their best. She chose music because doing music special, Dolly Marie Sherman, EMS. She did it special because each student was challenged by the types of music that she selected for her concerts and her performances. And that takes a special gift and a special talent. Wednesday, June 6th, I went to visit Dolly. This was probably before Pastor Dave went to see her later that evening. She was sound asleep. Her breathing was very labored, but she was quiet. She appeared to be comfortable sitting up, a little slouched. I didn't want to disturb her. I picked up her Bible, did some quiet prayer, thought about some things. I went home. I called Peg. I said, this is what I experienced with Dolly. She seemed comfortable, but I didn't wake her. I waited for Pastor Dave to come back later and wake her up and have that conversation. And she said she was ready. The next morning at 4:08, I woke up startled. I was lying flat in my bed, an experience that I've never experienced before. Something strange had occurred. I knew something strange had occurred. But also got the same sensation that I couldn't change this feeling.
I couldn't change what just happened, and it was okay that I didn't change what just happened. I looked to my right and saw that my life partner was still breathing, thankfully. So that wasn't the change in my life. So what else could this have been? And this experience lasted for several minutes. I looked at the clock, 4:09, 4:10. I'm still lying flat in the bed. My eyes are roaming my bedroom. There's enough light coming from the street light that I could see in the room. There was no one else in that space. And then a couple hours later, Peg sent me a message that Dolly passed. I asked her to spook me, and she did. So be careful what you ask for. So we grieve the loss of a good friend. Thank you for not letting me read my entire book on Dolly. But this is also a time where we need to reach out to Peg and to the rest of Dolly's family, because now there's a void there. And those of us that made the commitment to come today to share in Dolly's memory, I think also owe Peg a commitment to tend to your needs. You're going to be moving your apartment in the next month, I believe, or a couple more weeks. So when the call comes out from Peg, as partners in their relationship with Dolly and the memory we have for Dolly, we owe some debt of gratitude to Peg as well, that we continue in our relationship with her and give her the support she needs. Thank you all for attending and listening.
I forgot to add, some have asked about kettles next year. Kettles, it's going to be.
All right, we'll still have kettles next December. Okay. Very good. Thank you all for coming.
Yeah, we're going to get to Amazing Grace in just a second. I've got the mic now. We're going to do a couple of things here. Peg, I have a video that I'd like everybody to see here in just a minute. But it's been nice. Family and friends, thanks for coming. Peg, I don't know how long you guys have been here. It's really neat how the Lord works. Kurt Sayer, we were looking for a piano player because at the time we were pretty rough around the edges and we had some holes here and there. We're still rough around the edges. What am I talking about? But Kurt Sayer, the officer at the time, put an ad in the newspaper for a piano player, and lo and behold, somebody actually still reads the newspaper. They just happen to be 80-something years old. So these two old dolls came inside the core building, and the rest is history. They've really made an amazing impact on a lot of lives here at the core. 5 years, yeah. And a lot has happened in those 5 years. It's been a great 5 years. And I would say if you guys went to any of their other churches or Pastor Dave, these past 5 years, we probably got the best of them out of any other years of their lives. So I'd say they've probably had some of the best years of their lives right here. I know Dolly would say that. She loved it, and she really felt like home here, and she was. She was a big sister. She was an aunt. She was a mom to myself and a lot of these other people back here in the band and a lot of our young people. We don't have a lot of our young people here today, right now. It's just hard to get the kids here, outside of the usual schedule. But we do have some of them here. In a minute, we're going to attempt to play something with them just as a representative to Dolly's influence on young people's lives. And we want you guys to see, what she did, what her ministry was, what her music ministry was. It was grassroots ministry. She was completely and wholly devoted to not only teaching young people music, but showing Jesus, showing the light of Christ, the love of Christ in her everyday teachings. And so we're going to try and do that right here. But one of the things I want to say before we do that, it's nice that you guys talk about where Dolly grew up, where she came from, what she did. But, I don't know, that's not really who Dolly was, or is, I should say. You know, Dolly's a tough woman. That's who she is. And she's a soldier of Jesus Christ, is who she is.
Amen.
And she's a true blood-bought, born-again woman of God. Yeah. That's who she is.
Amen.
And I tell you what, she'll tell you what she's thinking, and she'll tell you the truth in a heartbeat, and, but she'll do it all in love because she only wants the best for you. And her only desire is for you to live a life to the best of your ability in Jesus Christ. That's her desire. Drake, I have to talk to you after this service because the day before she died, she spoke about you a lot. And she wanted me to tell you some things. And so after this service, I need to talk to you, okay? But another thing that happened the day before she died while my wife and I were there is that we just saw an amazing, amazing witness to her, who she is. And so I want you guys to see exactly who she is. You know, she may have had her doubts or whatever, but she loved Jesus with all of her heart. And I have no doubt whatsoever that she's seeing him face to face at this very moment. And so I want you guys to see this video with all the breath that she can muster, all the energy that she can muster. What is she doing? She's singing praises to God. We sat there for, you know, a good 15 minutes just singing with her, reading her the word, and she loved every minute of it. And so that's who Dolly is. She's the lover of Jesus Christ, and she wanted to, or she lived her life to show that love to everyone she met. And so, guys, go ahead and pull out your instruments. All right, we kind of threw this on the boys, and this is not all of them. I mean, this is only three of the boys. We've usually got a lot more kids than this. And our original plan was to play Ode to Joy, but just for to not freak them out, we're just going to play Hot Cross Buns for you guys real quick. With a little bit of flair, okay? Come on, guys, get up here. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Timothy Sherman. I'm Dolly's nephew. Really didn't plan on talking, but obviously, since we're getting ready to do this, I did want to add a little. You know, everybody's talked about how she touched everybody with her with music. It's a family trait. myself, my sister, my son, my nephew, my niece, we've all been into music. And a lot of the reason was because of Aunt Dolly. My niece Carly today is going to sing with me Amazing Grace. She's with the choir back home in Roanoke. So this ought to be pretty good. I'm going to let her run this show for us, okay? Oh, I'm singing with you, but...
Take Nathan into the next room and then talk and help him with his recorder, which he aced his test thanks to Dolly. but he wanted to make sure that everyone knew that he appreciated the time that he had with Dolly and Peg. This was hard, but he said, I'll stand with you, but you got to tell the story. and So he wanted to make sure that you knew that, Peg, that both of you were very instrumental. Do not pardon the pun. in his life. And I always say, when you minister to the children, you minister to the parents. And so Peg and Dolly, thank you for ministering to your pastors. We love you. I'd like to do the closing prayer, and then we'll have Tack. Yes. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you so much for the life and the ministry of Dolly. We thank you, Lord, for this time that you've allowed us to come to grieve and heal and celebrate. We praise you and we thank you and we lift you up, because Dolly would not want this to be just about her. She would want this to mostly and foremost be about God and about salvation. So Lord, thank you that today is the day of salvation. Thank you that we rejoice and that we have a hope that one day we will see her again. This life on earth is so short, but we will spend an eternity in heaven. And we thank you, God, that she is running and jumping and breathing without a machine, but she is mostly just praising, listening to those angels and saying, "Where's my instrument? I'm going to join in here." So we praise you, God, for her and her life and her ministry. Thank you, God. In your name I pray, Jesus. Amen.
So I'm Chris. Dolly taught me a lot. So. Nowhere near as good as any of these guys, but we do our best.
That's going to take place in the gym. If you go out these doors and go down the hallway, there'll be the restrooms on the left, and just after that will be the doors to the gym. I encourage you to come and speak with the family as you go. Maybe we could have the family go first, and so that we could have a reception line as they go in. I think that would be appropriate. So as the band begins to play this next song, we'll invite the family to rise and proceed out the doors to the reception, and we will follow shortly. Thank you again for showing your support today.